was fire. There was something of a time edge south of the river. There's something of a time dimension that is saying in Kentucky, I call it, we are in Southern Daylight Time. Plus we're south of the river. Anyway, I had to go out with you. My name is Richard Harris, I'm a pastor here, that's the God, my seventh year. On behalf of the parish, we are visited to Hopkinsville, where they put the less peaceful, adventurous, but otherwise intention. Okay. A Psalm of David, Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament proclaims the works of his hands. Day unto day worship his speech. Night unto night whispers knowledge. There is no speech, no words. Their voice is not heard. A report goes forth in all the earth. Their message to the ends of the world. He has pitched in the tent of the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom from his camp, and like a hero, joyfully runs its course. From one end of the heavens, it comes forth, its course runs through to the other. Not the States. Almighty God, creator of all that is, I give you thanks and praise for the wonders you manifest in the book of nature. For the truth revealed in the sacred scriptures, for your word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen. And as we begin praying, the word of the parish eclipse committee, which is an ad hoc committee, will shortly expand.
Official solar eclipse logo, and I assure you that we are not changing the locks. This will work. Are there people in the back who can't hear me? Stick your finger up your hand. All right. I have a couple more things I'd like to do before we get started and introduce Brother Don. And there's my son and I have a bookshop downtown in Hopkinsville. Many of you may have seen these plaques we're doing. I've cut a wooden plaque with the state of Kentucky outline, the eclipse path says solar eclipse 2017, a nice corona on it. And the top of these plaques have the St. Peter and Paul logo on the top. This board goes to Chris and Tina Brainy, who are here from Louisville as guests of Brother Guy. This board goes to Vince Adowski, his wife, at the new service. This board goes to Father Richard Merrick, our pastor, who was surprised to hear this. And this board is for Brother Guy. So I'll hand you all these later. I don't want to spend time coming up and shaking hands and hugging and doing that myself. So, let me introduce Brother Guy, the director of the Vatican Observatory since 2015. And long introductions just bore me and make me crazy. He grew up in Detroit, has a PhD from the University of Arizona. The Vatican Observatory shares scopes and research between Arizona and Italy. And Brother Guy, welcome you to St. Peter and Paul. We know you'll have a marvelous presentation.
In the 30s. still very important to maintain scientific research about, simply because there is still a lot of confusion about this relationship between science and faith. We are not out here trying to prove the existence of God out of the telescope. That's not what we're doing. But we can say that if we want to obtain reasonable results looking through that telescope, we need to do it embracing a certain work ethic that is, in fact, the same work ethics that the Bible itself tells us through the commandments, through the Gospels, to embrace.
Realize that you have an observer from the Vatican.
after the Vatican, the Vatican has had an astronomical observatory, and therefore observers of that sort, going back to 1891, but really, we do claim to go back to the reform of the calendar. The first interest that the church would have in astronomy was a very practical one. You want to be able to determine the dates of feast days. Now, our feast days in the Christian church are based on Easter, and Easter is based on Good Friday, and Good Friday occurred on Passover. So Easter is more or less the first Sunday after Passover. When it's Passover. Passover is the first full moon of spring. When's that going to be? Well, it is fun to be able to tell you when spring is supposed to occur. The ancient Hebrews in Israel worked it out empirically. They knew that every year there were about 12 times when the moon would go through all of its phases. That period when the moon goes through all of its phases is called a month. I guess we call it a month now. Only in those days, if you actually follow the exact moon, it's 29 and a half days. 29 and a half does not divide evenly into a year. So every year you have to throw in an extra month. And the high priest would sort of do that arbitrarily, randomly. So to be able to predict ahead of time when there's going to be a full moon in springtime, what is springtime? Springtime is the season that starts when the day and the night are exactly the same length. And that's determined by where the Earth is in its orbit around the sun. Vice versa, if you keep the sun goes around the Earth. It gets to be pretty complicated, even explaining why it's complicated. But it gets worse. Because after the fall of the temple, there were no high priests to say, this is when Passover is going to be. And the Jews would have to pretty much figure this out on their own in the diaspora around the world. And eventually the Christians had to figure it out for themselves, and they'd come up with a rather arbitrary way of doing this, connected to the Roman calendar. Now the Romans didn't care about months anymore in terms of where the moon was. They just knew that it was a convenient way to break up the year into 12 periods. And so, to make it more helpful, some months got more days than others to fill them up. You probably heard that Julius Caesar was the one who established the calendar and named the month for himself, July, and make sure that it had 31 days. And then Augustus came along and said, well, I'm going to name a month August, and I'm going to make sure that it has 31 days. So we stole the day from February, which is by February, it's short day. Now, a year is from when you have the beginning of spring to, once again, the beginning of spring. That's what I counted that down. Which is almost 365 days, but it's 365 days and a little bit more. And how are we going to count that a little bit more? Well, it worked out that it's actually almost exactly a quarter minute. So if you have a leap year every four years, you can be on schedule, and you're only going to be off by one day in the century. Which is nothing. Until it's 1500. And there are a few centuries gone by then. You're off by 15 days, you're actually off by 10 or 11 days. It's not actually exact. How are you going to make this all work out? On top of everything else, it's the first Sunday after the first full moon. What happens if the full moon occurs on Sunday? We will arbitrarily say it's the following Sunday. Okay. What happens if the full moon occurs when it's a Sunday in one part of the world and a Saturday in every part of the world? Because by 1500, people are sailing around the world. Christopher Columbus in 1492. And the Portuguese going around Africa. Settling in India. Finally, the Council of Trent, the same council that defined the seven sacraments and all the other things in response to those terrible Protestants. The Council of Trent orders the Pope to come up with
And he thanks the astronomer to come up with a really clever way of calculating what the full moon's going to be. And it turns out to be so complicated that someone else comes up and says, look, here's a formula that fits on one piece of paper that everybody can read, which gets it kind of right 15 years out of 17. And frankly, isn't that good enough? And then people go, yeah, it's good enough. So all those things you've ever heard about, Easter being the first Sunday after the first full moon, no, Easter is arbitrarily computed by a formula that actually has very little to do with astronomy. Nonetheless, they hired an astronomer, so they had to have an astronomer to run. The guy they hired to explain this to the world was Christopher Plagueis, the Jesuit mathematician. There's a great about the moon, Plagueis. Anybody who saw the movie 2001 Space Odyssey? They land at Plagueis Base. This is a real crater. It's a real moon. It's a moon. There's other two things. First of all, to make sure that you didn't have that losing day of the century, every fourth year would be a leap year, except if it's a century year. So 1700 was not a leap year. 1704 was. 1800 was not a leap year. 1804 was. 1900 was not a leap year. 1904 was. The year 2000 actually was a leap year, because the world made it really worth having that every fourth century year is a leap year. And it means that if we set our religious holidays arbitrarily, then we don't have to worry if we go to Mars where they have two moons, which one's going to be full, or if we're traveling anywhere else in the universe. The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. They could have just arbitrarily said, yeah, the second Sunday in April would be Easter. But they didn't want to do that because they didn't want to offend the other Christians. And eventually the Protestant world accepted the Gregorian calendar that we want to describe, made by the Pope Gregory XIII. Unfortunately, the Eastern Orthodox to this day have not accepted it, and so they have their own period when they celebrate Easter. And if anybody was fortunate enough to be offended, let's have Orthodox or not. Western Christian, he had, you know, two Christmases, which is not a bad deal. But I bring this all up to remind you of Christopher Plagueis, who was the mathematician who in many ways starts the tradition of Jesuits after his run. Plagueis wrote the textbook that people use for mathematics. He invented things like the decimal point. Very useful way to describe arithmetic. A very young Galileo wrote to Plagueis for a letter of recommendation, because Galileo had been using Plagueis' lecture notes when he was teaching at the University of Pisa. I also mentioned this calendar and the need for Passover at the first full moon, because in the weeks leading up to this eclipse, I have been asked more times by more reporters. Fortunately, none of you in this audience. Gee, I read in the Bible that there was an eclipse of the sun during the crucifixion. And I'm going, there was a darkening of the sky, but don't call it an eclipse. An eclipse of the sun occurs at noon, when the moon is between the sun. Passover occurs at full moon, when the moon's on the other side of the earth. So whenever the darkening that occurred at the crucifixion, don't call it an eclipse, please. How would we get that? We'll go back to Plagueis. Because Plagueis is someone who lived to look through Galileo's telescope. And the Jesuits had a big party when Galileo showed up at his house with his father. They had a big party, and Galileo set up on a hillside south of the Vatican, invited all the big shots of Rome at the time. The Pope didn't show up, but the Pope sent the Jesuit astronomers to be hired. a fellow who was had started the first scientific organization, the Academy of the Lasers. Prince Chisholm shows up, and he inducts Galileo into the Academy of the Lasers. Galileo is so proud of this that for the rest of his days, he signs his name not just Galileo, Galileo, but Galileo, Galileo, Lasers, a member of the Academy of the Lasers. Prince Chisholm invents a new word for this distance viewer. He invents the word telescope. And all of this occurs on a hilltop south of the Vatican, which is the location today of the American Academy. And on the 400th anniversary of Galileo showing off his telescope, they had a big party. They invited me up there. They invited David Sobel, who wrote a book about Galileo's daughters. We had a great time. After all, I don't know that I got to make a time story about that. It was organized by the fellow at the Academy who was in charge of all the American Academies. They have a house for American scholars from around the country to come and live for a year, do a sabbatical, study up on their history of Rome, the art of Rome, the archaeology of Rome. The fellow in charge of the history program organized this whole thing together. He looked like your classic history professor, kind of portly, had the tweed jacket, the patches on the shoulder, on the elbows, and he was showing me the area where they were going to set up the party. He goes, you know, I've always wanted to set up a disco here. Right. I used to do a little bit of DJing when I was younger. Yeah, right. I looked him up on Wikipedia. He used to be the lead guitarist of the Mets. He became a history professor at Athens for lessons. This idea of the church being involved in astronomy starts out with a very practical reason, to work out the calendar. But the Jesuits and their education bring education not just to the practical, but also they educate their students in the arts, they educate their students in theater, they educate their students in the things that make you a more complete human being. And there's a greater name for Galileo because there are in fact 35 craters on the moon named for Pleiades, I guess, or actually isn't for Galileo. There's a great name for Pleiades on the moon along with 35 other Jesuit priests, the brothers, prominent crater, which he named for Copernicus. And this is 20 years after the trial where Galileo was put on trial for supporting the Copernican system. And if you're puzzled, good. Because the more you look into the Galileo affair, the more puzzling it becomes. Everything you know about it is wrong, but the truth probably doesn't make the church look any better. The one thing is clear, though, when you read that the big transcript of the trial, when you read the documents that are available, when you read the history, the one thing that's clear is that nothing's clear. If you go to Amazon.com to come up with a good book about Galileo, there are 400 different biographies available, and every one of them tells a different story. Because this is one of the great mysteries. Galileo was friends with the Pope. He was an insider. Even when other people were getting in trouble talking about Copernicanism, he would stay free. He published books for 20 years. He was on the lecture circuit for 20 years. He was showing all the parties of the rich and famous. It was kind of like talk shows of their day. And then suddenly in 1633, out of nowhere, he gets in trouble for saying the same thing he'd been saying for 20 years. What's going on? What's probably not going on is that the church is afraid of science, because the church was supporting plenty of other scientists who would be arguing about the Galileo ideas and the Copernican system. And remember, the Copernican system had been around for 90 years. It came out right after the Council of Trent, or right before the Council of Trent, and the Council of Trent spent 20 years looking for heresy, and they never actually even questioned Copernicus. It's just marvelous and strange. And I bring this up only because everybody always asks me, the church, the Vatican, what about Galileo? And the reason they asked me about Galileo is they don't have anything else to ask me about. There are a series of wonderful astronomers and wonderful scientists working with the church, working for the church. The fellow who made that map are Jean-Baptiste Pujol, Jesuit priest. They have another Jesuit priest as well. 100 years later, a fellow named Roger Popsovich, who came up with the atomic theory. And also, with the fellow who pointed out, you know, that dome of St. Peter's is cracking. Here's how we'll fix it. And he did. 100 years after him, there were Jesuits who were interested in determining the size of the solar system. How do you determine the size of things up in the sky? Well, it's all done with triangles. If I know the angle between me and something that's fixed, and you over there and look at the same thing, see a different angle to the thing that's fixed, we can draw a triangle. And if we know the distance apart from each other, then you can scale up and find out how far the distance is to the thing we're looking at. So, for instance, here in our Hopkinsville, tomorrow the sun is going to be totally covered by the moon. But if you go 200 miles exactly in a direction perpendicular to the path of the eclipse, somebody's only going to see part of the sun covered. You can figure out how much of the sun is visible, work out from that the relative angles, and work out the distance to the moon. Right, you know, 200 miles times how many times you have to make that triangle work. In order to get that kind of observation for the whole solar system, you look for the moment when Venus crosses the face of the sun. And one person on one side of the world sees Venus crossing the sun at one part of the sun, and somebody at the opposite end of the Earth sees Venus crossing a slightly different part of the sun. You can work out the triangles and the mathematics, and if I had a blackboard here, I could show it to you. Be thankful I don't have a blackboard. This meant that people wanted to travel all over the world to be able to observe this. These transits of Venus occur twice every 120 years. The last was for 2012 and 2004. Probably some of you who are astronomy fans were able, how many people were actually able to see one of their daily transits of Venus? There were 100 years, our whole generations couldn't see that. Well, the first one occurred during the 7 Years' War between America and the Russian-Indian War. And the astronomers, originally, they sent some astronomers who were captured by the French. We know other same thing, you know, the French Navy, it was at heck of 11. Lots of individuals critically trying to observe this transit. There was a fellow named Lejeune-Thiel, who went from France, sailed to India. By the time he got to India, the city in India had been controlled by the French, was now controlled by the British. The captain was a great man, and so he missed the event, the transit, because he was at sea. He said, the heck with this, once I get land on land, I'm staying here for the next one. So he landed, he wakes 8 years later, it's cloudy. He gets in a boat, goes back home, and discovers that his letter, sorry I'm going to be late, never made it. He had been declared dead, all of his possessions distributed to other people, his wife is remarried. All for an event that, on the other hand, he's the one we tell the story about. We don't remember any of the other people. Well, there were a couple other guys who the British sent them. The astronomer Royal Lincoln was going to observe this transit in one part of the world. And he sent another astronomer, Charles Mason, to go to the Americas to observe the same transit. To be able to determine exactly where it was, they took along with them a surveyor named Jeremiah Dixon. And after they observed the transit in South America, they stopped off in Maryland and did a little survey between Pennsylvania and Maryland. You may have heard of the Mason-Dixon law. All due to since the big ship had such a tough time the first transit, the Royal Astronomers rented an entire ship just for their own use transparent, and at the last minute, the Royal Navy said, you can have this ship, but we want our own captain. There's a young lieutenant named Cook. And that's how Captain Cook started going to discover Australia and all the different places and finally come to a bitter end in the Sandwich Islands, or maybe Sandwich Island. Now, what is the importance of the transit of Venus in terms of the church? One quarter of all the observatories observing the transit of Venus in Europe were run by priests. And many of the observers of the transit of Venus elsewhere were missionaries who were trained in astronomy and brought their telescopes with them. The first double stars were discovered by missionary priests who were trained in France and brought their telescopes. Missionary priests trained in astronomy landed in China and were able to demonstrate the superiority of their astronomy over the astronomy that the Muslims have by using the Copernican system. Then the Chinese emperor said goodbye to the Muslim astronomers who run the Royal Observatory and the Imperial Observatory for the next several hundred years is in the hands of Jesuit priests. This idea of science being in the hands of the educated world meant that it was in the hands of the people who were running the universities. It meant it was in the hands of the clergy. Because the universities were founded by the church. And the people teaching at the universities were expected to live lives as clerics, not necessarily ordained, but many of them were ordained. You see me up here, that's all the time. There are any real kind of priest or brother of the order, I pass for that Jesuit. I'm kind of sloppy that way. Nobody wears cassocks anymore, right? Nobody does know that they're worn a cassock. How many of you graduated from high school and wore a black robe? How many of you graduated from college and wore a black robe? It's a clerical robe. Now, the old medieval universities had what they call grammar school, where you would learn grammar, rhetoric, and the trivial topics, the three topics, grammar, rhetoric, and... See if I have that slide up there. I'll think of the pick rocks when I tell you. And then, after you've solved the trivia, grammar, rhetoric, and... logic. Chris, where are you? Arithmetic was actually in the second. It was in the quadrivium. You got arithmetic, geometry, music, and astronomy. And then after you finished that course, then you would go on to the only degrees that really mattered, doctorates in either theology or philosophy. Well, that's the medieval university with theology and philosophy. The stuff that priests want to do. But nowadays, if you're going to get your most advanced degree, it's of course going to be a degree in, PhD. Pile higher and deeper. Doctor of philosophy. The medieval university system, founded by the church, is where science is invented. The people who we look up to as the forerunners of science often were religious. Priests, monks, in some cases, sisters. Who is the first person we call the father of chemistry? Roger Bacon. Come on. Who is the first person we call the father of geology? Alfred the Great. Come on. In later times, who is the father of genetics? Gregor Mendel. Come on. Who's the fellow who works out the idea that if the universe is expanding, that can explain why the universe doesn't collapse under its own weight, and if that's the case that it was expanding most of the time that it was all about a point he called the cosmic atom, but which Fred Hoyle made fun of, and called the Big Bang, because Fred Hoyle didn't want to believe in the Big Bang, because it had been mentioned by the Belgian priest, George Lemaitre. My own personal hero in this whole list is a funny Angelo II, in a judgment, and the tongue, so you know, got that out. Secchi did a number of things when he became the head of the astronomical group at the Roman College, which was the college that the Jesuits run, not owned by Gregory XIII, as they got a Gregorian calendar. Secchi was interested in a whole set of questions that no one began asking for. He was the first person to draw out a connection between solar activity and magnetic fields on Earth, the sort of thing that's actually really important to us now if you're worried about cell phones and how they behave if there's a big solar storm, or sometimes a big solar storm that can knock out the transmission of electricity, especially in Canada, when you're close to the magnetic North Pole. In 1860, he was, I think, the second person to photograph an eclipse of the sun. And he worked out a way that you could look at the corona of the sun just by putting a disc in your telescope. His work is so important that it's being continued now by a pair of NASA satellites that are orbiting the sun called the stereo satellites, with two of them. And each of them has a package, which is the Sun-Earth Connection Coronal and Heliospheric Investigation Package. Did you follow that? It's an acronym, spelled SECI. They're never going to make an acronym out of Consolmagno, I know that. But SECI part of that, he's infamous in one sense. He looked at Mars through his most powerful telescope, a telescope that he built on the roof of the St. Ignatius Church in Rome. Anybody here been to Rome? Anybody here seen the Church of St. Ignatius? If it's the church where you go in and you look at that dome is kind of dark. I hope they don't put a bright light on it so you can see the dome. And as you walk further, you realize the dome feels like it's going to fall on your head because it's not a real dome. It's a flat roof that's painted to look like a dome when you're standing in the front. They ran out of money and they didn't have money to build a dome. What it does mean is that they have a flat roof and four pillars that were big enough to hold the dome, but they didn't have a dome at all. So Angelo II built telescopes on those pillars. And they're up above, close to the city of Rome in the 1860s. They didn't have electric lights to worry about. And he's got this powerful telescope. He points it at Mars, and Mars is close enough to approach. And he starts seeing dark markings. And he's trying to figure out what these dark markings are. And he says, you know, they look kind of like canali, the Italian word for channel. The markings that he's seeing are real. 30 years later, another astronomer takes that same word and apply it onto illusions and begins with the story of the canals on it. But that wasn't Secchi. Secchi sees the real thing. Secchi does something else. He takes one of his telescopes and puts a big prism in front of the main lens of the telescope. So instead of seeing every star as a dot of light, he sees every star as a rainbow. But he knows that some of the colors in the rainbow are missing. And when he paints very carefully the colors that he sees in the rainbow, he sees that these dark lines are missing. And Bonhoeffer had worked out not that long before that the missing colors are evidence of the chemicals that the light has traveled through. So he's measuring the chemicals that are present in the atmospheres of the stars. Now, wait a minute. There was a famous French philosopher who had organized knowledge from the cult about 30 years before that, 1830. And he said, you know, there was a kind of knowledge that we know there must be knowledge, but we will never know it. We know the stars must be made of something, but we will never be able to determine what the stars are made of, because we'll never be able to go there and pick it up and bring it back. And Secchi is able to do this without going there. Why is this acceptable? One thing, he's beginning to say, I see all of these stars that have the same kind of lines, and a bunch of stars that have different lines. complete classification comes up by a fellow named Hertzsprung and Russell. And out of this, we get our entire understanding of stars glow, and evolve, and chain. We get the idea of the main sequence stars, the giant stars, the black dwarf stars. All of this comes out of measuring the spectrum of stars. But I want to pull back and recognize the real genius. Before Secchi, what was the work that an astronomer did? Now, I hired an astronomer, one, to make the calendar work. A few years later, somebody realized that you can navigate by sea and bring your boat safely across the Americas or around to the spices of India by knowing where the stars are. But you have to have a table of star positions to carry with you so you can compare the stars you observe with the stars that were observed back in London, or back in Paris, or back in Washington, D.C. So there's a naval observatory in Washington, D.C. to this day, and there's the Royal Greenwich Observatory. And the work of astronomers, the thing they were paid to do, was to measure the positions of stars. Secchi doesn't care where the stars are. He wants to know what the stars are. It's not just that he comes up with new answers that makes him great. It's that he comes up with new questions. Astronomy is not filling in the book of answers. Anybody who's been in this portion of going through high school physics, you know that high school physics is learning how to get the answers in the back of the book. And if you think that's what physics is, it would be the most boring work ever happened. Fortunately, it isn't. They make you do those problems the way that your piano teacher makes you play scales. They're finger exercises to build up your talents so that you can eventually come up with not better answers, but better questions. And that's one reason why I'm never afraid of science coming up with answers that will be different from our religious answers. Because we're not interested in answers. We're interested in questions. We're interested in wondering about the things we never even knew to wonder about. Furthermore, science and religion act on totally different levels. And you saw me talking there about how I really do have the courage to do my science. This is what I mean by it. Every logical system, you know, Euclidean geometry when I was in high school, any premise, any system of logic, you start with an axiom. You start with something that, but assume this is true. You know, the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. I can't prove it, and there was still a universe where that's true. And I built up 13 or 14 of these axioms, and from that I can deduce all sorts of other things. What are the axioms of science? What are the things that a scientist has to assume? Or else you couldn't do science. You have to assume that the universe exists, right? You know, I'm not just dreaming of science, it's just not that I had a really bad submarine sandwich this morning. And all of you guys are now figments of my imagination. I can't just prove that. There was a famous philosopher, the Zen philosopher, George Eddington, who said, I dreamt one day I was a butterfly. How do I know that I'm a human being who dreamt he was a butterfly, not a butterfly who dreamt he was a philosopher? And you can't prove that. All you can do is say, I'm going to assume I'm a human being. There is a universe. When I make an experiment and she makes an experiment, we're working under the same laws of physics. I have to assume that. I have to admit that there are laws of physics. What's a law of physics? A law of physics is just a shorthand description that tells you how nature works. It's a description. It's not a proof. Philosophers prove things. Mathematicians prove things. Scientists don't prove, they just describe. They describe in beautifully elegant ways. And their descriptions can suggest things that they can look for, hence the new questions. But it's not perfect. Of course it's not perfect. If it was perfect, then we have all the answers, and I wouldn't be asking the government for more money this year. The second assumption I make is that there are laws of physics to describe how nature works. If my goal is to describe nature perfectly with a system, I've got a system that works better than science. I can explain it to you. You want to know why the lovely bowl hit the church over there? Zeus, you're right. You want to know why your crops didn't do as well as her crops? You didn't say the right prayers to Ceres, the goddess of crops. If you think that everything that happens in the physical world happens because there are little demons and gods who cause it to happen, nature happens, then you can explain everything. Of course, you can't predict anything. Because these are highly unreliable and kind of nasty in their relationships with demons. You can make sacrifices to the hope that it does some good, but if it doesn't, it becomes not a demon. The demon doesn't constitute. Describes the universe perfectly. But if I don't believe in nature patterns, I can't use that as a description. If I only believe in one God, and that means I don't believe in nature patterns, then I have to explain, well, how come her crops didn't grow as well as hers? How come the church over there got hit by lightning and the grocery store down the street didn't? What's going on? What regularity can I see? You can think that it was all perfectly random. Or you can say, maybe there is, under all this confusion, an underlying rational order to it. Why is it that it was 100 years between times when we had a total eclipse of the sun covering the United States? But we're going to have another eclipse, in just 7 years from now. Seems random. No, I can understand the logic of how orbits work, and I can predict when these eclipses are going to occur. But notice this means that you have to believe in a universe which is orderly and rational and works by a certain rhythm and doesn't have room for nature powers. When Genesis tells us that God made things in an order, and when Genesis tells us in the beginning God was already there, was obviously already there before there was a beginning, before there was time, before there was space, was therefore not natural but supernatural. God said this, God said that, God did things in an orderly way, in a way that human beings can actually, at least partly, understand. If I didn't believe that the universe was orderly, and if I didn't believe that the universe was understandable, it would be a waste of time to do science. Now you can say, well, it works, therefore obviously we're doing something right. And that's true. But the first person to come up with the idea that there was an order didn't know it was going to work. Where did they get that idea? It's a religious idea. It's an idea that can be inspired and found in the way that we see God the Creator described in Scripture. Now, by not believing all these nature gods, I find myself on the same side as Richard Dawkins and Stephen Hawking. And that's not surprising, because they claim to be atheists, and I only believe in one more God than they do. We're not that far apart. There's one more thing, though, that's really important in order to be able to do science. You have to believe that it's worth doing. Anybody who's worked with NASA knows, oh, why don't we go to the moon? No, because we got Tang and Teflon, and we're just true. If we want to fill all the people, whether you're a lady or a tiny tough man, boy, do you waste a lot of money. Why do you go to the moon? Why do you do the other thing to the monitor? Not because they're easy, because they're hard, to quote President Kennedy. Why does the Vatican do astronomy? Why does anybody do astronomy? I was thinking of being a journalist or a lawyer or something like that. I was going to one of these schools in Boston. And my best friend was going to MIT. And I visited him one weekend with a freshman. And I discovered at MIT that the world's largest collection of science fiction books. So I transferred to MIT to read science fiction. And when I got there, they said you have to declare our major. So I went to MIT physics. Engineering, and the other thing I've been able to hammer is noise. I'm not going to be an engineer. Earth and planetary science, I had no idea what that was, it sounded fun. Got planets in it. Planets are places where people have adventures. So I signed up for that. Discovered when I got there that I tracked I was now in the geology department. Geology? Rocks? There's a rock. There's another one. What am I going to do? And then we discovered there are rocks that fall out of the sky from the asteroid belt called meteorites. And you can actually pull pieces of outer space. And this is so exciting that I leapt into the field, continued being in love with meteorites and meteorites. A whole story of meteorites and ice that interact with the ice and moons and how they left out and how they met the oceans. And I was doing this for a good 10 years. I was a postdoctoral fellow at MIT, at this point, man, 30 years old. Now, MIT's the big time, right? I've got a student there, I'm a postdoc there. I was in there, I was for big leagues. You told me if you were too big. But I would go to bed at night, and at 3 in the morning, lying in bed wondering, why am I doing astronomy when there's people starving in the world? And I took that answer. Of what possible use is this to anybody? And I didn't have an answer. There's no problem so big that you can't get away from it, so I joined the Peace Corps. I said, I'm going to do something worthwhile for the world. Mr. Peace Corps, send me wherever you want to send me. Ask me to do whatever it is I can do. I don't have an agenda, you tell me. They sent me to Nairobi, Kenya. They said, you're going to teach in a remote school where there's no black and the blackboards and no windows and the windows. I said, yeah, right. Help out kids teach me. And then they saw my record and they said, oh, right, we're sending you to the best high school in the country. We've got lasers and computers. This was 1982. Okay, they did that for, I was there 3 months, and they said, no, you're going to go to the University of Nairobi and teach astronomy to graduate students. I got them that back in Boston. Well, okay, the guys I was teaching at the University of Nairobi were all students getting master's degrees so they could teach science at the Kenya Science Teachers College. And one thing I already learned in Kenya is that, you know, people who live close to nature, there's a word for people who live close to nature, it's called hungry. For all the problems of technology, the Lord knows there are problems with technology in society. Nonetheless, a technologically sophisticated society is the only one that can feed its people on a regular basis. And to feed the people of Kenya, you need a technologically sophisticated society, which means you need to have an educated populace, which means you need to have teachers, which means you need to have a teacher's college, which means you need to have me teaching the teachers of the teacher's college, and if astronomy helps in modern physics. That wasn't the reason they wanted to learn astronomy. Every weekend I go all country to visit my fellow peace corps volunteers. We're off in the places where I saw windows and windows and black and black horses. I'm sorry, I missed them. And I would bring with me a set of 8 slides of pictures from spacecraft missions. And these places would often have slide projectors that ran on car batteries to project these pictures, and everybody in the village would come to hear my talk. And I had a little telescope that I set up, and everybody in the village would come and look through the telescope. And they go up and look at the moon, the craters on the moon, and they go, ah, anybody here see the craters on the moon through the pyramid binoculars or telescope? Yeah, pretty amazing. Then they see the moons of Jupiter, and they go, wow. Anybody here see the moons of Jupiter through the telescope through the pyramid binoculars? Yeah, pretty astonishing. And then I show them the rings of Saturn. Is there anybody in this room who has ever seen the rings of Saturn and not gone, oh, wow? Doesn't exist. And they were going, oh, wow, just the way that my family back in Michigan would go when I showed them, just the way I would go when I looked at them myself. And it suddenly occurred to me, saying, oh, wow, when you look at the rings of Saturn, is something that my dog or my cat doesn't want to do. It's something only human beings. And my Vedic people, even in the remote part of Africa, have the chance to look and to see and to wonder and to go, oh wow, meant that they were more than just well-fed dogs or cats or cows. It meant they were human beings. Human beings capable of amazement and wonder and joy and something that had nothing at all to do with filling their stomach. Because you know, we live by more than bread. We do not live by bread alone. I read that someplace. And it is literally true. And it changes your life when you suddenly realize the universe operates under a system where you can find answers to problems if you learn how to break the problems and the smaller bits that you can handle. And you don't have to live in poverty. You don't have to live in starvation. And you don't have to live thinking that I'm nothing but a machine and eating and drinking and that other thing machine. That I am a human being capable of appreciating who I am, where I am, and capable of appreciating and having the joy of wondering about who I am and where I am. And that's why we do astronomy, even though there are people starving in the world. I saw a news report saying that with the eclipse tomorrow, the productivity of the United States is going to take a hit of $400 billion. Isn't that a shame? You know the old definition of the cynic, the fellow who knows the cost of everything, the value of money. This is why we do astronomy. But here's the last twist. That sense of joy that you'll get when you see the eclipse tomorrow, or even if you only see clouds, you feel the darkness of the pole and the weird light around you, when you hear the birds going crazy, or suddenly silent. It's worth experiencing even if you don't get to see it. But that emotional sense is more than just an emotional sense. It's a heck of an emotional sense. It's a sense that speaks to your soul. It's a sense similar to what I get when I'm doing science and I make a discovery, and maybe only people in the world will care about that, but I care about. And I feel the finger of God saying, yeah, wasn't that great? Because that's the same emotion I feel in those rare but unforgettable moments of prayer. When you know God has spoken, and in this enormous universe, God found the time to find me to speak. And you're amazed, and you're scared, and fear of the Lord is a real thing, and it's a gift. And it's a gift, a gift. I hope tomorrow, looking up at the sky, remembering that we're in a universe that is real, that makes sense, and that is worth being heard, because it is an expression of the Creator who is. Thank you very, very much.
There's two different meanings of creationism.
If by creationism you mean God created the universe, I go, that's true. But you've got to remember that God creating the universe is not something that happened 13.8 billion years ago and then God washed his hands and walks away. It's not something that happened 6,000 years ago. It's something that's happening right now. The creation of the universe occurs continually. God continues to will the universe to exist because God is outside of time. Someone asked me to comment on the September 23rd celestial phenomenon of the whole close of the sun involving Virgo and Jupiter and other planets. I'm not going to answer this one, I'm going to direct you to a thing called the Catholic Astronomer, which is a blog site that we have where we have a number of different astronomers who are affiliated with the Vatican Observatory writing on topics of interest. And Chris Brady, who's in the audience, wrote a beautiful description of what this celestial phenomenon might be about, why we don't think it's supernatural, but why it's still up. Why does the shadow of the moon move from west to east and not east to west? How does the earth turn? If we see the sun rising in the east, it's because the earth is turning in the one direction, but the moon is moving the same way that the earth is turning. But the earth is turning faster than the moon. So if I've got that right, is the earth turning underneath the shadow as the moon itself is moving through the sun. That's all you need to know. But stars and planets are going to be visible during your childhood. I don't know. That's one of the things I'm looking forward to finding out. The stars that are next to the sun now are the stars that are high in the sky at midnight 6 months from now. Right? Because we're on the sign of the sun where all of those stars are in the secret light as you pass the sun. You can't get the sun somewhere. But 6 months from now, we'll be on the other side of the sun. So it's August, and then we're talking all January, February. What stars are visible in January, February? A lot of the bright stars in the visual constellations. So take a look and see if you can find the right. Take a look and see if you can see the twins. I don't know. And of course, everybody will see something different depending on how dark the sky is, how good their eyes are. Write it down. Write down what you see. Write down what you experience as the eclipse occurs. They say that poetry is a profound emotion recollected in tranquility. But I think that's science too. Pay attention to it, write it down, and then somebody someday, maybe you, 10 years from now, will have a good time reading that and saying, oh, I remember. What I expect to learn from the eclipse is what I don't expect to learn that I'm looking forward to learning. I've tried going to eclipses before. I've never been able to see totality. So I'm prepared to be surprised. And I'm trying to go in with as little preconceptions as possible. The danger is always that people tell you what to see and that's what you look for, and you miss out the cool thing they forgot to mention. When I was at the Peace Corps in Africa, I read all about Africa, and everything I read about was true, but Africa was nothing like I expected. And I hope it's a true eclipse. I'm from Detroit. Where in Detroit? I originally was born and raised in Harbor Woods, in Our Lady of Peace Parish, and then moved out to the Birmingham area to Our Lady of Margaret's Parish. So I was under Our Lady, but from east of Harbor. Is it appropriate to pray for a sunny day tomorrow? That's something. Please do. 30s, and they thought pretty sophisticated cabinet. And still wondering what my life was going to be. I said to myself, you know, God loves me, and God's just kind of curious to see what I'm going to do with my life. It's not like he's got some overall master plan that I have to figure out. He's given me the freedom to live whatever I want. And by the time I was 40, I stumbled into the Jesuits and realized, you know what, God actually did have a plan. Ooh, maybe I should have prayed a little bit more about figuring out what that was. When I was in Antarctica, in collecting meteorites, and the weather was coming in, and in Antarctica, there were literally 6 people together in tents, so you never talk about politics, religion, or sex. You don't think that's not nice and logic. But the head of the camp came to me and said, Guy, that weather's coming in. If we don't get the planes to land to take us out, we stop here another week. Do you think you could say a prayer for good weather? I'm not going to say my prayer was worked, but I'm going to say we got out. Pray for good weather. Better than that, though, is to pray to appreciate whatever you're given and to learn whatever it is God wants you to learn from. But in the meanwhile, well, I came to Hopkinsville. The reason I came to Hopkinsville is I found a biker standing waiting for me. And the more I thought about it, the more I prayed about it, the more I thought, this is the place I want to be. I was invited to go to some big fancy conference out in Wyoming, where, you know, the odds of clear skies are much, much higher. They said it's going to be cloudy next month. I never thought you guys would have gone there. Can we figure out what the Hudson's a great weapon in that zone? And because of that, we can work out, of course, when different events occurred in history where the historian said there was an eclipse at this time. It's not as easy as you think, because the moon's orbit is perturbed ever so slightly by other planets. And even very, very fast computers have a hard time keeping track of that and all the perturbations. But pretty much we can do that now. Among other things, it confirms that those ancient historians describing what they were describing. Why are people drawn to astronomy? For me, looking at the stars is both beautiful and subtle. There are some people who like paintings of Elvis on the back of it. And I'm going to tell you that they're Jesus. Or that, whatever, you know, people can make fun of people who like to do something about it. But I like things where I have to engage myself a little bit more. I like things where I'm looking at a painting, I've got to spend some time to appreciate the subtle things that the artist is doing with each of the figures. I'm looking at two paintings of the mind. And okay, there I said, God, I'm shocked. Well, there's more going on there. Spend some time thinking about each of the people and remembering that they're people and remembering that we're talking about human beings who actually existed and bled and walked and looked at eclipses the same as you. I love looking at the stars, especially the stars that are hard to see. The bright ones tell me where to start looking. But then I like picking out what the faintest ones I can find. I've had a little telescope, and I love seeing things that are big and bright in the telescope, but then I like looking for the little faint things that I'm not sure I see. And that tells me that the appeal of astronomy to me is not only that there is something rich that I can appreciate immediately, but there's an afterglow that draws me in even further. And while I'm looking at the stars, well, Let's just say the weeks after 9/11, I spent a lot of time looking at the stars. And remember, the universe is a whole lot bigger than what 9/11 represented. When I think of stuff that happened in my childhood, you know, it was 48 years ago this week that Woodstock occurred. How many people here under the age of 35 can name three artists to play at Woodstock? And that was, of course, a reaction against the Vietnam War. How many people under the age of 35 can name one general of the Vietnam War? Or even who was the president in 1969? All right, how many people under the age of 35 can name one of the Apollo astronauts that landed on the moon 48 years ago? Probably a whole lot more. The universe and our understanding of the universe outlasts generals and upstarts and worries and threats. Gee, was I going to get a passing grade on my entrance exam? Which is what I was worried about then. We talked about Galileo. Galileo got in trouble with the Pope. Who here knows the name of the Pope? And Chris Grady, you can get up your hand. Who here remembers that the Galileo trial occurred during the 30 Years' War, which was the biggest Europe has seen at that moment. And maybe that had something to do with why the trial took place. Astronomy puts everything else in perspective. And it does it in a way that gives us pleasure. Which is something I have to remember astronomy students, or not just astronomy students, if it's not fun, you're doing it wrong. If you pick all the grants in the world, you pick all the papers published in the world, but it's not fun, you're doing it wrong. Maybe that's true of other paths of, you know, walks of life. I don't know if you talk about astronomy. But if it's not, God wants you to be happy. And if you're not happy, you should not be telling God it's doing it wrong. Maybe that's God trying to tell you you're doing it wrong. And I'm down to my last question. Considering the logic, order, and coherence of the natural world, how probable is it that it's only the product of chance? What's a great example of chance? Paradise. What's a great example of chance? For gravity. Anybody here in your shop ever tried to make a paradise or a roulette wheel? It takes phenomenal precision to make a paradise in our region. To make a roulette wheel that actually gives you a fair chance. People seem to think that there's been a contradiction between chance and design, when our best examples of chance require phenomenally good design. I don't know how God makes the world work. I've spent enough years as a scientist, but now I don't know. But I do know that God uses every trick in the book, including chance, including design. And sometimes chance is by design. I have a funny image that I get from my father. I have a tremendous two images. Image from my father. Knowledge is like an island. The more you know, the bigger your island. But the bigger the island, the longer the shoreline. And the shoreline marks the region, the boundary between what you know and the ocean and the stuff you don't know. So that the more you know, the more you realize you have that to learn. And that's why scientists will always be coming back next year to ask for more brain But fathers, and what I'm not going to do, I grew up with my father, who's 99 years old, and I love him dearly. I love him more dearly now than when I was a little kid. There's a bunch of journalists. One of these days she's going to find out I'm losing her this way and she didn't hear about that. But a bunch of British journalists named Emma Thompson. She writes the government column for the Independent and something like that. But she wrote an article a few years ago that I read online about her childhood growing up. And she thought that her dad was a wonderful person. You hope that every little girl thinks that dad is a wonderful person. All right. But as she grew up, by the time she was maybe 11, it began to dawn on her. She began to realize that her daddy, Pete Thompson, really was a rock star. The guitarist of the Who sold millions of records. We are in that situation with God. We know God first as Abba, Daddy, Father, our Father. We know Him as the intimate Father who's there when we pray. But only as we learn astronomy do we realize that this God who is there and so close and warm to me personally, and you, not sure about you, and you, that this God is also the God who made the Big Bang, and the supernova, and the nebula, the space. What a remarkable God we have as our daddy. Go out tomorrow and see the cool thing he set up for us to enjoy. Thank you very much.